இந்திய பொருளாதாரம் ஒரு பார்வை என்ற தலைப்பிலே திருமதி மிருதுளா ரமேஷ் அவர்கள் உரை நிகழ்த்துவார்கள்.
டியர் டாக்டர் ராஜீவ்குமார், மிஸ்டர் கண்ணன், மிஸ்டர் ஸ்ரீனிவாசன், மிஸ்டர் சுந்தரம், லேடிஸ் அண்ட் ஜென்டில்மென், இட்ஸ் அ பிளஷர் டு பி ஹியர். தேங்க் யூ. ஸோ வென் தெர் ஆர் ஜாயன்ட் சிட்டிங் ஆன் த ஸ்டேஜ், ஐ எம் கோயிங் டு கிவ் அ வெரி வெரி பிரீஃப் ஓவர்வியூ ஆஃப் த இக்கானமி அண்ட் லீவ் த ஹெவி லிஃப்டிங் டு தெம். Overall, the economy seems to be growing at well over 7%, which makes India one of the fastest growing large economies of the world today. And rural India is doing well. And that means rural consumption is doing well, driving growth in sectors like two-wheelers and cement. But if we were to read the headlines today, if we were to read the papers, we'll see that the headlines are all about stressed assets resolutions and the lack of jobs. Okay, so what's going on? The popular narrative, and I'm going to use a nearby example, the popular narrative in the case of Sterlite is you can either have the environment or you can choose the economy. You can't have both. And I believe that's a false choice, and I'll explain why. At the heart of this narrative, which says you can either have the environment or you can have the economy, are two beliefs, right? On one side, one group believes that nature is an inexhaustible sink. I had some nice slides, but either the slide seems to have disappeared, so I'll try to speak what I can. On one side, you have a group that believes nature is an inexhaustible sink. You can do what you want and it'll take it. On the other side, you have a group that says environment, environment, but is unwilling to pay the cost to manage it sustainably. Very often they hide behind saying, you know, India is poor, so we cannot charge things like water to farmers. So when the economy and the environment are caught between these two beliefs, one that says it's a sink and I can treat it how I like, I don't have to incorporate it in my decision making, and the other side that says we can't pay a cost for it, you're caught in a situation where you don't manage the environment. And we got along until now with this thinking, but only now the environment is fighting back. So how does that work? It works because recently, last month, the Niti Aayog released a report that said 600 million Indians, that is one in two of us, lived in a situation where they faced high or extreme water stress. Most of us in Madurai will, you know, before ipo mara penjirathukku munadi or rendu maasathukku munadi ellarum thanni vaangittirundhom, like all of us could attest to that water stress. So let us translate to what that means for the economy. When you're under water stress, when you're spending time when you don't know when the water is going to come, you spend time that you could otherwise be engaged productively in contributing to the economy waiting for water. And then you try to squeeze value out of that water. So you are not as clean as you need to be. If you have only 4 kodam, okay, 4 buckets of water to manage for 3 days, you may not be as clean as you would like to be. Which means that leads to a situation where 200,000 to 300,000 children every year die of diarrhea, primarily because of sewage mixing with water. Let's look at two examples. We can talk of Shimla, which is far away, or we can talk of Madurai, where we all live in. My institute just finished a survey where we spoke to about 1,000 households in Madurai, right? And we asked them, what is the reality that you face in water today? And what we found was shocking. 40% of Madurai buys water, not for all their needs, but to meet some part of their needs. Na inge ketta paakrene, inge ethana per thanni vaangringa? Yeah, roughly the survey is holding true again here. 30 to 40% are buying water. And what that results is, in Madurai, we are the outer neighborhoods. I won't name the neighborhoods now, but outer neighborhoods, there are whole neighborhoods where the houses are all locked. You can't take a house there for rent because there is no water. We are living in day zero. What in the South Africa, what we read there is true here. The houses are all locked. Groundwater kadaiyadu corporation liyum thanni varadilla. So in day zero, that is a stranded asset. So if a bank has lent to finance a house in that neighborhood and that house can neither be lived in nor rented out. That's a stranded asset. So when you fail to manage the environment is a drag on the economy. Is this the only narrative? So does that mean we take only the environment and leave the economy? I said that's a false choice. I had a superb photo in my presentation, but I don't have the presentation, so I can show you on my phone when you guys come over. But the con is, take a desert country where there is no water, right? You would think that that exacts a huge cost on the environment. But in Israel, the latest study shows what the water economy adds 0.5% to GDP growth in Israel. So how do they do it? It starts with every Israeli, every household, every farmer, every company pays a price. It is a differential price. That is, a farmer pays less and a house company pays more. But that's fine. But everybody pays a price. So what does that mean? When everybody pays a price, there's obviously a meter, Ilya. So everybody is aware of how much they're using and they know how to manage that. And the price they pay allows for companies in the back end to innovate and come up with innovations that can use water better. The photo I had is actually a complete desert with no water around, but plants as far as the eye can see. And if you stand there, you'll believe, right? And that's possible because they're able to treat sewage to such a good thing, and we have it in our factory also now. The price that they pay for water is able to create companies, company after company after company. And what I do is, one of my hats that I wear is I invest in small startups, right? In India, there are very few startups in water. Even though we are 600 million Indians are facing water stress, but there are very few startups in water because we don't pay a price for it. So the companies can't come up with innovations for it. Whereas in Israel, there are hundreds of companies, leak managers, water treatment facilities, hundreds of them that are there. One last example I'll take and then I'll move on. Recently, there is a plastic ban that has happened. And there are many people here, small business owners, etc., who say, this is a bloody pain. You do a plastic ban, how will I manage? How will I give packaging? It's a huge drag on the economy. But Mr. Kannan is in the spinning industry. I'm also in the spinning industry. The spinning industry's profitability derives from the management of waste. Right? If you manage waste, the product, it has spawned an entire ecosystem creating thousands of jobs. And the products that are created from the waste in the spinning industry finds its place in the rupee notes that we use today, or the jeans that somebody might be, the jeans that you're wearing, for instance. In my house, I know by managing waste well, we save about a cylinder or two of gas a month. And in our factory also, we've started doing it. So what I wanted to say is this. As long as you say environment or economy, where one group says, I'll ignore it, the economy will fight back. I mean, the World Bank recently said that by 2050, climate change will hit the Indian economy by 2.8%. So we are going at 7.7% today. That number will come to 5%. It's not good. That will definitely lead to a more jobless situation than it is today. But if you incorporate the environment into your thinking, one side saying, yes, I'll incorporate, but all of you here saying, I'm willing to pay a price for it. I'm willing to pay a cost for managing water better or managing my air better or managing my waste better. I think the environment can become a powerful ally in growing our economy. Thank you very much.